ladies and gentlemen. And our thanks to the Stanger Hospital Choir. Thank you very, very much. Your Excellency President Festus Mogae, former President of the Republic of Botswana, members of the Luthuli family, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, and with your permission, all protocols will be observed shortly by our welcoming address. Thank you all very much indeed, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us at this year's Chief Albert Luthuli Annual Memorial Lecture. And this year, it's a themed Luthuli Remembered. It's another opportunity that we get to keep in memory one of South Africa's finest, finest sons. Under very suspicious circumstances in 1967. And so this year, 2017, marks 50 years of remembering the life of this selfless leader who contributed and gave his life in the end in the service of his people. Now, one of the founding tenets of these memorial lectures has been that it should be delivered by someone who in many ways was like-minded and showed the same kind of qualities and leadership characteristics that Chief Albert Luthuli did during his lifetime. And that's why this year we're very honored and privileged to be graced by the former President of the Republic of Botswana, President Festus Mogae, whose own leadership has been lauded throughout his life, not during his presidency, before as well as after, as he continues to do great work. Chief Albert someone scored a goal in a football match, and I want to share that with you. So, as a courtesy to our speakers, that we can share some of the things that are coming through, and that we can tweet and share with everybody else. So, much of this will be streamed on our YouTube channel on the SABC, so that everybody can capture this year's memorial and listen to the profound words, I'm sure, that will be coming through during the course of this afternoon. But let's begin, and I think the best place to start is a few words of welcome from the University of Kwa-Zulu Natal, who's been a key partner of the Luthuli Museum, as well as this annual memorial lecture for many, many years. And representing the university is
Luthuli and the family, the Luthuli Museum, members of council, members of the Luthuli Foundation, members of council, University of Kwa-Zulu Natal, members of executive management of the university, deans, academics, students, and officials, and from the government as well as the Luthuli Museum. We have some representatives from the Itakwini municipality as well as Musunduzi municipalities. Alumni, captains of industry, members of the Grafton community, and members of the media, distinguished guests, a hearty welcome to the University of KwaZulu Natal on this day. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome all of you at this very auspicious event, which is now the 11th Albert Luthuli Memorial Lecture, which is held every year in conjunction with our partners, the Department of Arts and Culture, and of course the Albert Luthuli Museum. Poverty, social cohesion, strife, and just a few short weeks ago, and to take the opportunity to visit this museum. I think this is a good experience to go through the facility and to reflect back on the past and the times that we all are reflecting about today. As from 2018, the University of KwaZulu Natal will also be housing the Albert Luthuli Foundation at Howard College. We found premises right adjacent to the UKZN Foundation, and we hope we can work hand in hand. As an institution, we also strive to live the ideals that Chief Luthuli so espoused and fought for. Just like Luthuli, who never forgot his African roots, the University of KwaZulu Natal, by competing and extending its influence at a global level, seeks to advance African scholarship and root itself in its local community. Our African roots are reflected in our academic garb, in our logo, new anthem of the university, and most of the stakeholders present here today know that this university is guided by its value system, what we call REACH. It stands for respect, excellence, accountability, client orientation, all based on the foundation of equity and inclusion at the university. In striving for excellence, we have undertaken to display quality leadership, servant leadership, and energy in all we do. The institution also promises all our actions. All the ensure that we satisfy the needs of our clients, while lastly we pledge to be honest in all our dealings, and this includes our pledge to deliver with integrity and to promote sound ethical practices. If one studies the life of Chief Luthuli, it's easy to see that these UKZN rich values are what underpinned his leadership. 50 years after his death, the great teacher and leader continues to impact or impart on us some important life and leadership lessons that we can take forward. It's my wish that you will all walk out of this room today more inspired and eager to serve humans as did Chief Luthuli. May we lead the fight against injustice in whatever form or shape it manifests itself. Let me close by quoting from a message Chief Luthuli wrote in 1960 in celebration of 100 years since the arrival of indentured Indian labourers. In that message he said, "Peace and friendship, fairness and justice are lasting foundations of society. We should dedicate ourselves to the realisation of these values in our country and in the world." So with these few words, I welcome you to this gathering and thank you for joining us this afternoon at the University of Kwa-Zulu Natal.
On your behalf, I'd like to say thank you very much indeed to Dr. Pinyasvelt, the Vice Chancellor and Principal at the University of KwaZulu Natal, for this continued partnership and support of the Luthuli Foundation Museum, and making sure this lecture, this memorial lecture, continues to happen. And most importantly, thank you very much for the work that you're doing in guiding the young people under your care. Because they very much hold our future and their future as well. And if some of those values that you talked about that are very much aligned to Chief Luthuli is one of the things that they leave university with, then you'll have done a great job. Thank you very much indeed. To happen and to speak the opening remarks. It's my great pleasure to welcome the ambassador.
Vice the Ministry of Arts and Culture, the chairman of the board of the Luthuli and the Luthuli, the members of the I should actually be protocol to good afternoon. We are meeting here today, and as Professor Panyas has indicated, on a very special occasion, the annual lecture, memorial lecture of Chief Albert Luthuli. This year's lecture, of course, as you can see, is under the title Luthuli Remembered. In other words, we are here to remember the life of Chief Albert Luthuli, his contributions to making a very important goal of restructured. There are quite a number of challenges that are relevant nowadays. It is actually in order to remember some of these contemporaries, those who actually sacrifice for us to actually realize a situation where we say we are a free people despite the challenges we are facing. Especially public lectures like this one, it should not merely be a case of reminiscing on your life, but we should reflect on our own calling. In changing, of course, South Africa, the continent, and the world. By having listened and engaged in today's deliberations, we should actually be asking a very important question. We should be actually encouraged this active sort of generation. Start rounding off towards the end. In a speech he gave these leaders, he said, have a vision that generations would actually contribute and ensure continent, but actually taking it and actually engaging. We say the elders are actually a resource of wisdom and knowledge. It is in this context here today is indeed, you are honored, Mr. President, the Department of Arts, University of Kwa-Zulu Natal. next year's lecture. It also would be right to welcome this memorial lecture.
Quite well. So, yeah, the future is every single day that followed those past round upon us and wondering what are we doing? Some of the social questions. The young people here. It's in the to this and positively to some. So there's great work in preserving the right to put on to advance the culture.
Dean's academics and from the Minister of Arts and Culture. More importantly, I give special greetings to our speaker for this lecture, His Excellency Mr President, Mr Festus Mogae. This year's lecture takes place not only within the context of the 50th anniversary of the death of Chief Albert Luthuli, but also within the context of the centenary commemoration of the life and time Oliver National Tambo. Both Chief Albert Luthuli and Mr. Oliver Tambo lived and worked well together. In fact, sometimes Chief Luthuli at his home in the East Rand in Johannesburg and came for his political campaigns and meetings in Johannesburg. Similarly, the year 2017 metaphorically reunites these leaders again. At the Department of Arts and Culture, we also look forward to this time of Chief Albert Luthuli Memorial Lecture. It is not only because it provides an opportunity to families of Chief Albert Luthuli, as well as where we come from as a country, but also to reflect on the importance of collaborations and partnerships between institutions in achieving a common goal. Thanks to mutual beneficial partnership between the Department of Arts and Culture, the University of Kwa-Zulu Natal, the Luthuli Museum, Grateful community that has ensured the immortalization of the memory of Chief Albert Luthuli. Our department, the Chief Albert Luthuli Lecture, which was conceived in 2004 as part of the department's legacy project, has been one of our successful strategic interventions. The Luthuli Lecture 2001 to provide an opportunity for the African population at large to represent the chief and the vision of those before us who believe that the future is today. This memorial lecture, which is about to reignite to fight and stand for what he believed and died for, and that is a better South Africa, a better Africa, and a better world. With those few words, I wish you all the best in the program. I thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Ndima. We thank you and the department, actually, for the continued work that you do to make sure, as you said, that the fine heritage of this country, not just in the objects and the things that we see, but particularly in the people that we celebrate over time, continue to be remembered and treasured. Thank you very much indeed. So the time has come for the moment that we've been waiting for, that we've come from far and wide to hear. And as you've heard, the person delivering this year's annual lecture is not a mystery anymore. And we're very grateful and honored and pleased that he's able to have joined us. As I said earlier, one of the founding principles of this Chief Albert Luthuli Annual Memorial Lecture is to invite leaders who embodied some of the core values that Chief Albert Luthuli displayed throughout his remarkable life. So that through these lectures, perhaps we'll be able to celebrate the best of our leadership on the continent with a view to enriching our people and carrying on the work one way or another through the work of leaders in the past, like Chief Albert Luthuli and the man that's going to be delivering the speech this afternoon. So our keynote speaker is a man, much like Chief Luthuli, gave his life, continues to give his life to public service. Trained as an economist at the universities of Sussex and Oxford, and school if it's produced two presidents, right? And he was also at Oxford University. He started his he has continued to fight the good fight, particularly for things like democracy and the work that he's been doing in helping the elections and monitoring them across the continent. And otherwise, I think that it really speaks volumes to the kind of man that he's been, most which celebrates excellence in African leadership. It's awarded to former executive heads of state and government by an independent committee composed of eminent figures, including two Nobel Prize laureates. So, President, and one of the few that has given this award since its inception. So, to deliver this, Chief Albert Luthuli Annual Lecture, and ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to welcome His Excellency Mr. Festus Mogae, former President of the Republic of Botswana. Mr. President.
Pray be seated. Director of Science, Vice Chancellor and Principal of the University of Kwa-Zulu Natal, Dr. Albert Luthuli, Chairperson of the Chief Luthuli Museum, Mr. Jabulani, and members of the Council, members of the Luthuli family, former Member of Parliament, Dr. Albert Luthuli, Your Excellencies, Ambassadors, here present with us, members of the Council of the University of Kwa-Zulu Natal, Executive Management, Deans, Academic Staff, representatives from Municipality, from community and the UCCSA, known as LMS in my country, members of the media, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Allow me to thank the organizers of this memorial lecture for having considered me worthy to address you on this important lecture series commemorating Chief Albert Luthuli. Chief Albert Luthuli is one of the historic and heroic figures in Africa's political history. He was a distinct freedom and human rights fighter. His major strategy peaceful resistance and a passionate belief in peaceful coexistence of people, communities, and nations. In the context of the peace, I have chosen to focus my address today on peace as the inheritance that he bequeathed to us as the Sadc region, the African region, and indeed, the world. I know there have been many dignitaries with more profound knowledge and better experience of Chief Albert Luthuli's life and works who have stood here to address you before my address today. Indeed, a great deal has been said, written, and is already known about this towering son of Africa. I am therefore honored, humbled, and privileged to also stand here this afternoon to share with you the little I learned and now know about Africa. I believe these values should continue to be the most African today. Because I am from a village in Botswana who, like many in South Africa and the African continent, has benefited from the fruits of the struggles and personal sacrifices of many of the founding fathers, such as Chief Kwa-Zulu, Chairman the Third, Albert Luthuli, Nelson Mandela, and many others who sacrificed their lives to advance our freedom. In Botswana, for instance, we hold in high esteem our three chiefs, Kama, but with the Kama the Third, not the present Kama, no. Kama the Third, but with the First and Sibylle the Second, who fought hard to stop Botswana, then known as Bechuanaland, from being handed over to John Cecil Rhodes' private British South Africa Company, BSAC, in the late 1890s. Accompanied by the missionaries of the then London Missionary Society, now the UCCSA, our gallant heroes traveled all the way to the United Kingdom to convince the British government not to hand over the governance of my country to a foreign private interest. The struggle for freedom did not end with the visit of three chiefs to the UK in the late 1890s. The next generations of chiefs continued the struggle from 1910 up to the 1960s, following the establishment of the Union of South Africa in 1910, several attempts were made to absorb Basutoland, Bechuanaland, and Swaziland, the so-called BBS territories, into the Union of South Africa. Our successive chiefs, among them Sekete Kama and Batwin the Second, and many others across the region, fought against this incorporation. The struggle against the incorporation of South African authorities on the religious, trade embargoes, and other manipulative pressures on those considered ringleaders against the incorporation of the BBS territory. Anyone who thinks our chiefs were stupid needs to revisit the history of the struggle waged by African leaders against white supremacy. In the same way as the honored Chief Albert Luthuli, great patriot and freedom fighter, we are celebrating the monument of our three chiefs who traveled to the UK in the 1890s. I am highlighting the resistance of the chiefs in fighting for and asserting the right of the people to personal freedom and to action because the basis of in the late 1990s. The battles were preceded by non-resistance measures to which Chief Luthuli was one of those whose voice could not be drowned by the oppressor. It gave the Nobel Prize. It signified Chief Luthuli's long commitment to peaceful resolution of differences. We are gathered here today to honor and remember a life well lived. Chief Albert Luthuli bequeathed to us a tradition of tolerance, love, mutual respect, multi-racialism, and above all, peaceful settlement of differences in all spheres of life. He remains not only an inspiration to African leaders, but also a symbol of peace upon in Zimbabwe and South Africa. His own father, I understand, was a pastor and an interpreter of the Word of God. His mother was a dedicated Christian who brought up her children under strict Christian values combined with strong African customs of Ubuntu, or Ubuntu. Am I saying Ubuntu? Oh, Ubuntu. Anyway, Ubuntu. That's the same as Ubuntu. And humanism. A blend of African values and Christian tradition produced people of distinction with deep understanding of the values embedded in Ubuntu and the principles of freedom. Chief Luthuli left Zimbabwe in his youthful years to Groutville village in KwaZulu Natal province, where he was further raised under the same Christian and African values and custom by his paternal uncle, also a chief and a devoted Christian. Chief Albert Luthuli, therefore, inherited a balanced mix of African and Christian traditions. As renowned South African authors Wallis Roth and Khumalo have noted, molded him and many others of his time into a peaceful but formidable personality. These attributes enabled him to lead not only the people in the region, in this region of South Africa, but in the rest of Southern Africa and the whole of the African continent. Chief Albert Luthuli was an effective and impactful leader who believed in peaceful coexistence, social harmony, freedom, and equality before the law. The question that arises for us who received peace as the most powerful tool from Chief Albert Luthuli, and others like Nelson Mandela, is whether or not, as African leaders of today, we are promoting peace and leading peaceful communities and societies. Put differently, the question is there peace in our communities, organizations, countries, regional and international bodies? Have we squandered this inheritance of peace, like the billionaire prodigal son in Setswana Morosi Sinji, who asked for his inheritance from his father only to squander it and return to his family a pauper? Could it be that we as individuals, families, communities, and nations have squandered the principles of Ubuntu and a peaceful way of life that our forefathers bequeathed to us? We currently face challenges at the personal, community, national, and international levels, and that we do not seem to be able to manage them. Are we treating the peaceful character of African leadership and forefathers sacredly and respectfully, or have we departed from the values of Ubuntu and acquired the individualistic and selfish character that encourages a culture of exclusive self-interest, which contradicts the African communal personality? Is this why throughout the continent, families, communities, and nations are tearing each other apart like Cain killing his brother Abel? Ladies and gentlemen, these are key questions which we soon use to measure the extent to which we are still living the Luthuli values and customs. We should every year, as we gather to remember the peace-loving ancestor, take time to search and revisit the way we live our lives today. Allow me to briefly share with you my experiences both as a former president of Botswana and the current chairperson of the resolution of the conflict in South Sudan. Botswana was bequeathed to us as a peaceful nation by our ancestors, some of whom I have mentioned earlier, and by the architect of independence, among them the late Nesreta Khama, the late Sheikh Kila Masire, Mr. Kimedi Shomotite, Mr. Mayempo, Matante, Mr. L.D. Raditani, and many other distinct people. These leaders share a similar principles of both freedom, equality, and dignity of all people, regardless of their religion, race, ethnic group, class, and age. They made these principles and beliefs the foundation of the Botswana that I had the privilege of leading from 1998 to 2008, when I recently headed the base of my successor, President Nesreta Khama, Ian Khan. My primary role as the third president of Botswana was to ensure that the rule of law remained supreme, that the country remained rooted in a transparent, accountable governance system that is responsive and caring. I endeavor to make justice, equality, and equity as the fulcrum upon which Botswana's advancement is framed and preserved. As you can imagine, it was not easy. Like your country, South Africa, and the rest of Africa, we had challenges. The challenges of access to land, to education, to health care, job opportunities, housing, and security of all Botswana and those who live among us. All these were keeping us on our feet. The strong force of capitalism, of injustice, of male dominance and patriarchy, tribalism, and even in some cases, racism, had to be fought and repelled. We had to protect the poor and the disadvantaged groups and groups who, as elsewhere, lacked patience for reforms and tended to generally dislike state-driven welfare programs. Crime and drugs were other challenges and threat to our peaceful existence as a nation. We had to come up with new laws and strong and functioning institutions to deal with these challenges. When we had differences of a serious nature, we would stop and reflect and then adopt different conflict management mechanisms to address the political conflict. For example, within a political party, consensus building was primarily built through caucuses and consultation to incorporate and or accommodate different views. For major interpolitical party differences, we created an informal structure called party conference, where all political parties, including those outside parliament, could meet and iron out their differences. On some broad national issues, such as concerns about the land distribution, language, ethnic equality, or any other questions, we used the strategy of presidential commissions to get opinions from across the country on that issue and come up with clear recommendations based on consensus and having to stay their peace. These strategies and approaches spoke to the national principles of the very sign consultation. And why be well, freedom of speech. But literally, he who speaks the alleyway speaks his own. That's the literal translation. But it means everybody is entitled to the respect. Yes, and the tolerance of difference of opinion, regardless of one's social status in society or the community. All these threats to our speech above all, these threats to our nation's peace and stability, and decimated our people. This was the prime section of our population, namely the youth and adults. It therefore directly threatened to wipe our whole nation, as we would no longer reproduce our population. We had to devote enormous amounts of resources to provide health care and maintenance of the widowed and orphaned. It is at this stage that we resolve to give ARVs to all AIDS patients at great cost to the nation. Thanks to the support of the international community, we were able to mobilize resources and save many lives that were destined to premature death. We have not totally solved the challenges of HIV and AIDS, and it still threatens our peace and stability. But our health education interventions, combined with treatment, have not only delayed loss of life, but it is also reducing the transmission of HIV from expectant mother to the unborn child. One can only share with you the experience where I think this one is a big challenge. The West has passed. The West, but not that is why I then joined our other brothers, such as Shisano in Mozambique and the former president of Tanzania and others to call ourselves champions of a HIV-free generation. So we are still preaching and talking and boring young people because we fear that the shock effect of the many deaths has passed and complacency has set in. And the reality is that in all of our countries, the whole continent, infections had fallen dramatically, but they are now creeping up. Because now those skeletal people are no longer seen around. But the enemy has not gone. Regarding my involvement in South Sudan, you will recall that 5 years ago, we Africans all celebrated the coming into being of Africa's youngest and the world's youngest and 54th free nation in the independence of South Sudan. As Africans, we celebrated Africa's independence, the South Sudan's independence from Khartoum, because we thought the suffering had been far too much and the death toll too high. We knew that the leaders and people of South Sudan were yearning for peace, but this, as you know, was not to be. Our first disappointment was the breakout of fighting between the leaders in South Sudan in 2013, between the president and his first vice president, in which human rights violations and atrocities were committed. This remained protected until a compromise agreement was reached in August 2015. Hence our role as the Joint Monitoring and Evaluation Commission on the implementation of the peace agreement in the Republic of South Sudan, and which has been an onerous task. First, because the new state of South Sudan had only entry or governance institutions such as parliament, judiciary, and the executive. The constitution as the supreme law of the land had to be written. The traditional leadership institutions had collapsed due to sustained conflict and different cultural settings of the Islamic State of the previous government. Our tasks have been to build consensus by inclusion of all principal players, including the ruling party and different opposition parties and ethnic groups. We had to consult extensively the constitution-making process to create a cabinet, parliament, financial management structures, and accommodate new developments that, for instance, required some renegotiation of some parts of the original peace agreement. While the Commission has achieved a great deal,
ladies and gentlemen, I thank the former President of the Republic of Botswana, President Festus Mogae, for your thoughts and your words, your memories, and also sharing some of the time that you were President, you were able to overcome some of the challenges that your country has and the important work that continues when you consider countries such as South Sudan. I hope to unpack some of that and some of the issues that you raised about our young people and some of the things that they need to be concerned about as we continue now with our panel discussion. And I'd like to call upon right now actually people to join us on stage. We're going to start to, which we'd like to extend to you as well in the audience to pose your thoughts and your questions as Chief Albert Luthuli is remembered. And as I said, it's not often that we get great leaders such as President Mogae with us. So please, let's use this opportunity. And I think by a process of it's just happened organically, hashtag Luthuli Remembered is the hashtag that we're using. Let's get the message out of some of the important messages that are coming through. In the meantime, please put your hands together to join us on stage. Ms. Nanangobese, Director of the Chief Albert Luthuli Foundation, to join us on stage. And Mr. Jabulani Sithole, Chairperson of the Luthuli Museum. So they're busy getting mic'd up, and so what I need you to do, kind of reflect, and we've heard these messages, 50 years on, 1967, when Chief Albert Luthuli passed away, Question. The leaders of that time opened the door, they fought a good fight, got us our independence and our freedom. And so the question is, as the president was saying, what happens now, as we heard from Mr. Sotoli, what happens now? What do we do now in 2017 going forward? Let's explore this and other questions, and please get your questions ready as well as I join my. Chief Albert Luthuli died. Botswana literally was 1 year old as an independent state, and you were still in your 20s, and you had a whole future ahead of you. It was a time of hope for Botswana, countries across the continent, and yet across the border, South Africa's struggle was still very far from over. And then all of a sudden, you received the news that Chief Albert Luthuli has died. Take us back to that time, and what do you remember of Chief Luthuli and hearing the news?
We were all very saddened because Chief Luthuli was a famous man already at that time, a man of peace, a man who was addressing the challenges of our region. Could live together, that all problems could be resolved by peaceful means, understanding. He was he had already been recognized.
Many, many years later, you yourself became a president and a head of state. And I wonder that you picked up in his leadership that you thought, you know, Luthuli used to say this, or Luthuli said this, and that you brought it.
I would say that his philosophy, and perhaps likely for me, the national temperament of Botswana were consistent. He preached resolution of conflicts or disagreements by peaceful means, by talking about them. That is consistent with our traditions and our practice. We Botswana, if anything, talk too much and can over-consult sometimes, but otherwise we have the same problems as all other nations. The only thing where I can claim, and therefore claim, that we listen to Luthuli than perhaps some of our other cousin communities in South Africa and elsewhere, is that although we have the same problems, we follow the Luthuli's method. We persevered, we persisted in consulting. As I said, we had problems about land, about ethnicity, about the languages. Remember, we have about 11 tribes, but the official languages are Setswana and English. These challenges, and what we did was to talk about them, appoint commissions, to consult, and then bring these issues to Parliament, and then I personally go around and sell what we think should be done, asking for here are the totality of the table to us. We have agreed on provision of water in a desert. We would analyze the structure of our public service and Parliament and see and show that it was representative of all our ethnic groups, in spite of the fact that only two languages, English and Setswana. And point out that English is the language with which we communicate with the rest of the world. Setswana was the one that is commonly known by the other groups. We don't have to spend new money to teach people, whereas any one of our other languages, if we tried to, we need many, much more resources, both human, financial, and other. And the question was, here is the totality of resources. These are the projects to which it's allocated. These are the priorities we had agreed about education and training, about public health and primary health care, about physical building of roads in our communities, so that towards the nation building. So we achieved some relative success. At least we avoided the conflict.
And not but a success.
Economic concept of opportunity cost. Opportunity, if we have if you buy something, the monetary cost is high. The opportunity cost is each of other things that you could have done with that money.
You brought up, we call it.
As a chief, as an activist, and the president of
is about that. It's about not even your money. It's the money that government has entrusted you with.
What is that destroys the African?
And what me, I don't have to do anything with me. Tomorrow you will need the neighbor when something actually happens. And I'm not saying this in a bad way, but when we move to we have some
Zimbabwe, Kaunda, with
it's exactly little did we anticipate when
to have
in the heart of